Welcome to Happiness at Work, powered by Happiness.me. Happiness at Work is a video knowledge series where we discuss different facets of employee happiness. Our objective is to find what makes employees happy and the business outcomes of a happy workforce. Today, we have Ashish Anand, the Chief Human Resource Officer at the SAARI Group. Ashish, a true blue HR professional, has spent 2 decades managing HR for several companies such as Piaggio, Tabor, and Relicon. So Ashish, welcome to the show, Happiness at Work, powered by Happiness.me.
All right, thank you very much.
You know, when you started your career, say 2 decades back, was the term happiness, did you hear the term happiness or employee happiness or happiness at work? You know, how was it back then? You know, we all probably, you know, started the career in the 90s. Sure. The environment, the work environment was very different. What was it back then, you know?
Okay. Let me attempt it in two facets. So two things which I understood. What was happiness to me when I started my career at that point in time? And what in general, what did you experience at that point in time? What made people happiness at that point in time? So when I started my career, the biggest happiness I got was after passing out my MBA when I joined the company. Was the day when I landed there, there was a bouquet of at the reception for me. That felt that, you know, at the 22, 23 year of your age, someone is welcoming you with a bouquet and a name. At those days, it used to be no electronic, but those pins name were there on the board. And, yes. And that, I felt like, someone who has arrived in life. That was a small, I mean, if you look at in today's context and the way today's world currently moves, I think at that point in time, that was a big thing. Just a management trainee out of college is being welcomed in a particular manner. And the first check of the happiness of the first salary, which was earned after 30 days of my work, I think that happiness was unparalleled. I haven't been able to replicate that happiness in 21 plus years of my experience yet. So that was, I think, it was that. At that point in time, I think getting a call, I mean, if you look at the whole environment of those days, and I started my work in 2000, and that point in time, the paper memos were still in the force, and the world was just moving, transitioning to a digital era, not digital era in terms of at least putting paper into machine and things like that. I think in those days, a small celebration brought a lot of happiness to people. A call from the line 2 manager just a good word from a senior management would bring a lot of cheer in people's mind. The aspirations level were very, very different than what we experienced today in aspiration level. So that's what I would say in a very brief summary.
Now, when you joined your first job as an HR professional, did you hear the term employee happiness? Was that in agenda back then?
No, I don't think so. The employee happiness was an agenda back then. I think that at that time the word was largely used was employee satisfaction. Okay. But how satisfied do you feel at your workplace? And that satisfaction over a period of time in a few years time, I heard the new term which was being coined as employee engagement. And after that, then it became more as an employee happiness. Involvement, etc. And I think the satisfaction level at that point in time was largely classified in those days in a very simple manner, is that do you feel comfortable at your workplace? Is your food great in the canteen? Do you have a bus facility which takes you to your workplace, or you don't? There were a lot of hygiene factors which were there at that point in time which drove satisfaction. And if I just draw parallel to this today, I think some of the hygiene factors are taken for granted now. You got to be there, otherwise anyway you don't exist in the minds of the employees or the minds of the probable candidates whom you want to hire. So that's where the satisfaction came in. Happiness was, I think there is one important aspect we must look at, and the happiness and see, the competition was also pretty less than what you see today at this point in time. When I started my college, that time, the dream which a lot of people used to carry, that if you become a vice president or head of the department at the age of 50, I think you have arrived in life. Today the world is that if you are 50, you have to really struggle to get another job at the age of 50. So I think world has dramatically changed over a period of time, and thus the happiness and the satisfaction and the engagement quotient has also changed drastically in last 20-21 years.
You know, if I talk about today's generation, standing in today, you know, what do you think happiness means for employees today? So let's say, you know, you described how was your first day, you know, at work. Now, if somebody is joining at your place, what do you think, what are the different, you know, facets of happiness for them? Or what are the hygiene factors of happiness for them today?
So you know, the hygiene factor has completely undergone change. What used to be considered to be privileged earlier is almost a given. Given that you have to have that. When you walk into office, if your work desk is not prepared, your machines are not there, you are considered that you don't take care of your employee. You don't leave a good employee experience. You don't leave a good impression about. So the hygiene factor is taken for granted, that it has to be there, and it is like that. There is a fundamental shift in the minds of the employee and the organization, both has happened, is that employees are now also being treated as a customer. And that's where a lot of things gets propagated, and which is why consumerization of the function, consumerization of the process, consumerization of various things are happening. So I think the hygiene factors are given. So just look at it this way. You would spend a full half a day, little over half a day in just filling up the form. Today, you with the technology, you just do it before joining the office. When you arrive, your employee code is ready. Your I card is given in few hours time. Your machine is given in few hours time. You go through a very structured induction program, etc. So that's given one. What brings happiness in people's mind, in today's mind, and if you look at today, is that what kind of pride do you build in the employee's mind? So do I feel associated with a company where I am able to contribute something significant, and that builds pride in me, whether irrespective of a junior or I'm a senior or a middle manager. So I'm contributing meaningfully in the company or not. Am I aligned with the purpose of the company or no? So there are if there is a misalignment of the purpose of individual and the organization, I think no matter whatever you do in that sense, the happiness that doesn't come in, and in a sense of fulfillment and in fulfillment in a way that what I want to do, am I able to do it or no? So I do need to be heard, irrespective of whichever level of the organization you are. If I have to just put four broad words around it, is that pride, purpose, fulfillment, and being heard. This brings momentary happiness. The consistent happiness only comes in with the fairness and the trust which is being built in the organization. And rest everything else, you know, you have the office cafeteria is being taken care of, you have enough employee meet and greet parties happening together, your bosses are treating you with respect. All that is given in today's world. And there is no tolerance level for not having it.
How has the work life changed now? You know, I just wanted to understand, why so much emphasis on employee happiness? Is it because of societal changes?
It's a societal changes, and also I think over a period of time, if you look at and you go back to the 50 years of your industrial revolution, the world actually moved from industrial revolution to services to technology. If you look at what people deliver in 30 years of age, 35 years of age, people couldn't imagine in the 50s, 60s, 70s and 80s that one could deliver that. So the pace of change is very rapid. the contribution of contribution to the company and the contribution to the society is very, very, very rapid. The wealth distribution is also significant in today's time. So how do you build? So in a fast-paced growing environment where the world is just becoming prosper and prosperous every year, and if you look at 20 years of my working career, 21 years of my working career, what prosperity people used to have in 2000 when I started and what prosperity people have at the same level is very different. So I think it's a mix of society, it's a mix of economics, and it's a mix of world, how it is changing. And also you have an access to the whole world at the same time. So where the happiness one and what draws happiness for what will draw happiness for you is very different than me. And this is where the whole world has changed. People used to be in a herd mentality in earlier days, in 2-3 years, decade, is what happiness was. But today's happiness is very, very individualistic by nature. It used to be, but I think it used to be suppressed, in my view.
You know, today you have got a multi-generational workforce. You have got people across age groups. And obviously what happiness would mean for a 50-year-old in the company would not mean the same thing for a 25-year-old. So how do you bring in that oneness to your entire happiness program or employee benefits program?
So I have a slight disagreement, and it's a question which is generally and often asked.
Yeah.
So multi-generational workforce was always in picture. So there was no difference in that. What changed is the access to the world and access to the information. And that's what has changed.
Okay.
The telecom revolution and the internet revolution has actually changed a lot of thinking process of people. So at the end of the day, the happiness for a 25, 30-year-old guy is to do a bungee jumping, and for a 50-year-old guy is to happiness is that the kid goes to the Ivy League B school, or the kid gets settled or gets married. So the happiness actually is also depends on at what stage of life you are. So for an organization, what one needs to do is that you have to design a policy, and all company, I mean, at least we do that. You design a policy which caters to all kind of need. So at the junior most level, you have to create little fun and frolic where they feel engaged. At the senior level, you have to create a policy, or you have to create a ecosystem where they feel secured in the organization. So that's where you have to start balancing your program policies and the treatment.
Okay, so designed as per people's needs and individual needs of employees, you will have to there can't be one common agenda for all.
So the days are gone are the days when you had one to many policy. You had to basically design a multi-generational work policy in design a manner that it brings in harmony, but it also caters the different needs of different set of people.
See, what has changed, I think today, what has changed is, earlier when you talked about multi-generational, there was the earlier generation would always look up to their predecessors and would like to be like them, or would like to, there was one uniformity, when we were growing up or when we had started. But the generations, down the line, or the current generation, the current younger generation now, they think very differently. They don't want to achieve what we have achieved or what, their predecessors have achieved. It is completely opposite. Probably the change is there.
Yeah, I agree with you. And there's a reason why change is there, because in our time, the access to role model was very limited.
Yes.
Today, the access to the role models are widely spread. What makes somebody successful, you could actually get driven by what made somebody successful, or what in Spain and sitting in a small town in any of the city, you could end this, which is when you see a lot of startup, a lot of new companies getting born and emerging out of it. So I think it's also a function of the accessibility of the information, accessibility of the world, accessibility of your exposure. I think I'll fairly and squarely just classify like that. I mean, and I can give you an example in 50s and 60s and during my grandfather days.
Yeah.
People's inspiration were, and people used to get inspired by Mahatma Gandhi. People were inspired by Nelson Mandela, because those were the people who talked about it. The leadership levels have also changed. So today, if you're a political leader, you are not most liked by people, and your people don't follow you. Today, if you are an economic leader, people follow you. If you are a Hollywood or a Bollywood leader, but you're doing a cause to society, people follow you. So there are different ways people look at the followerships. The lens with the followership looks at the leader has completely undergone change.
So people follow causes rather than personalities.
Absolutely.
Post the COVID, you know, work from home has started. Work from home was always there. It became popular. It was forced upon, and you know, people had to accept it. So do you think work from home has made people happier, or it has actually, you know, the happiness level has deteriorated? So, or there are two totally different segments of people,
There are two segments of, I think, it each to its own. There is no one size fits all approach. I think if you look at the initial, when the work from home started, and it created a lot of uncertainty in everybody's mind, and almost 5 billion of the 7 billion population in the world were under lockdown. So there's an anxiety, fear, etc., all that. The first fear was that, will you live? Will you get infected? First you have to live well to do anything else in life. So that was the first fear. The economic activity suddenly came to stand still and halt across the world, which suddenly nobody was prepared that will I my income be affected, my etc. will be affected. So suddenly you had that level of insecurity. So in that sense, everybody started to put in extra amount of work and extra amount of dedication, and which led to excessive number of hours being put in the general workplace and or from a work from home. I think those were initial, my reaction at that point in time was there. It's a heightened situation. It will even out over a period of time. I think that we are seeing it also. It's evening out over a period of time. What it has brought a lot of people is that it has brought a lot of people closer to the family. I have a small kid. I'm fortunate that I could see him growing in last 1 year, and I, because most of the time I was at home. Even if you're working, but you have a 5 minutes break, you can go and see what, or at least from a distance also, you can see your kid, what he's doing, or a family, what is it doing. So it brought families together for sure. You had better understanding of, and I don't think so spouses ever stayed together for such a long period of time on a 24/7 basis. Otherwise, you are almost a guest. Both spouses are working, then almost you're a weekend husband and wife kind of a thing.
Yeah.
It's more transactional in that sense. In that sense, it brought. See, if you look at, I think there is. I would look at it did a better thing than any. See, look, one thing has become very clear, that you can actually be effective from working anywhere. You don't have to be in front of your boss to be effective, as long as you're, which is why I say that if you build a purpose in the organization and you build a pride in the people, I think everything else is irrespective from where you work is taken care. You need to meet humans. Humans can be only dealt by humans. That's a given fact. But whether you have to meet every day 9 hours under a watch to make it successful, that's a question mark. I think certain people would have gone through little difficulties in terms of they had to manage their household work and etc. Some bachelors had to face a difficulty. But I guess people find it very useful at this hybrid model of, even if you work for 2 days from home and 3 days in office, it serves a good purpose for everyone.
I just want, you know, there is a perception that, the MNCs, or the multinational companies, you know, they're better in terms of work culture, you know, a lot of happiness, because of, you know, there are certain fancy things which attracts the millennial or the new generation of workers. Yes, Indian companies also have their own set of happiness, their own way of operating. How do you think, you know, the two differs? You know? Obviously, I'm not saying that, you know, employee happiness is not, and you know, a part of an Indian company versus you know, a global MNC. But there is a general perception. People, you interact with a lot of youngsters, and they want to say, yes, I want to work with an MNC. That MNC culture or a global company, you know, is a sense of achievement or brings in a sense of happiness. You know.
So I'll tell you what. So very simple. If you have to just decipher this in a simple word.
Yes.
Is that people, and I said that people, why do people say that an MNC is where a lot of people prefer? And
yeah.
So it basically associated with the pride.
Yes.
Okay. It basically, if you underline theme is nothing else. MNCs and all companies are commercial companies and driven by P&L and the shareholder wealth creation. They are equally ruthless in every aspect.
Yes,
so
certainly.
It builds with the pride. Okay, and the pride and the satisfaction, and then it builds in the confidence in the society and things like that. So any company which is successful, whether it is an Indian company or a multinational company, will bring in the same amount of pride. And there are various large Indian organizations where there is a pride quotient is built in. Now, if you look at the history of the large successful multinational companies, they have a history of 100 years, 60 years, 80 years, kind of a thing. If you classically look at Indian economic scenario, actually opened in 1991, and real economic growth started in 2000 onwards. So it would give little time for the Indian companies to come to a stage of maturity where they start building that kind of, and there are many companies in the Indian ecosystem. They are actually very aspirational in the overseas world also, and they can attract any talent. If you today think of any large successful or a mid-sized successful Indian company, they attract talent from wherever and whenever and wherever you think of. So it's a simple quotient of whether you build a pride and a purpose. If you build a pride and a purpose, all companies are similar. Successful companies have a similar philosophy to follow everywhere in the world. Is that treat with fairness, treat with equity, treat with respect. And give whatever is required to be given. If you if you follow these four principles, I don't think so. Any company is different in that sense. I would just like to classify it in that sense.
So you think Indian companies need to, you know, work on that perception, need to change that process somehow, or it's okay, you know?
No, not necessarily. We are the way we are. There are a lot of great companies I would want to classify. In fact, if you go to B schools, they are basically ahead of many of the large multinational companies in the premier B school or the engineering colleges. If you think of the startup world, you go to premier engineering colleges, you go to anywhere else. Whole startup ecosystem is the buzzword. There, none of them actually originated from any other country.
Yeah.
In fact, there is a tendency for people to look at startup and the newer age companies, which has no multinational background. So it's a mindset where you want to look at. So I think that's where if your desire is to be 100% safe all the time, just have certain things around that. The companies which are in India, they are headquartered in India. Imagine you are working in a company and you are headquartered in Washington or New York, and if you're based out of New York, what would you do there? So that's where I would leave it. I wouldn't classify it too much amongst them.
You know, I was reading somewhere, you know, that is the role of companies are basically deploying cognitive behavioral techniques, you know, mindfulness interventions, or resiliency training in increasing employee happiness. Do you think these things, these kind of you know, techniques really work in increasing employee happiness, or is it more of gimmicks? And
I really don't know how to comment on this mindfulness. Mindfulness means what? I mean, you should know what you're doing in life,
yes.
etc. I think it goes a lot with the background, what kind of education you have gone through, what's the pedigree you belong to. I fundamentally, if I personally believe that if you don't know yourself well, nobody can tell you what you are. You got to know yourself well, and you could be right or wrong, but your own your perception, you should be
the there. Self-belief has to be there.
Self-belief has to be there. There are another principle, if you look at, everybody is entitled for their own opinion, but the fact is only one. For the same fact can be looked at by different people, but differently, but the fact remains the same. So in respect of the mindfulness, resilience, training, etc., these are these soothing. See, basically today we are living in a world of a lot of anxiety and information down overload in here. In that sense, somewhere it does help to people, but will it permanently help someone? I don't know about that. I really don't have the answer. I have personally not gone through any of these programs to go through that. But I'm sure there are a lot of value. People may be finding it.
I just read another thing interesting. What the companies are also organizing happiness training and teaching employees how to be happy.
I'm giving you a simple basic principle. Build pride, build purpose.
Yes.
Treat with respect and fairness. People will be happy. Okay. If you do everything else, but if you keep abusing somebody, treat with lack of respect, no clarity, he or she will be unhappy. And the most important aspect of anything else is that just build empathy around it. So, we lack empathy in today's world. I think that's where everybody is coming around.
So at SAR Group, what do you do to, you know, what do you think, you know, these are the key ingredients that makes your workforce happy? So would you define the happiness quotient of working at the SAR Group?
So I can give you, we are an Indian company, but a very fast growing Indian company, multi businesses created in less than 10 years time. Though the group has a history of creating large businesses and sometimes exiting it and sometimes building it for.
Yeah.
So one of the key principle and the value system which we have, we call it AIM and ACT. We actually try imbibing that culture in everyone in the organization. First of all, we give a lot of comfort that you are first of all secure in the organization. So there is, you don't have a risk of generally being harassed by somebody generally. So I'm just saying that we just try building the purpose, pride, their connect in the organization and their meaning to their work, what they do. And we have fairly open culture. It's a very consensus building organization. It's, if you're a senior and if you're a CXO in the company, doesn't mean the people will start following you. You got to build your own credibility before people start following you. So it's a long journey which takes for any organization to come to, and that we have been working for a very, very long period of time. Each employee in the company is equally valued as much as anybody else in the organization. So that's how we build. People have an access to chairman, people have an access to any of the CXO. It's a very open culture. That's the way we define.
Do you think you know, it's easier to maintain a happy work culture companies which is smaller in terms of workforce spread? The larger not the company, the challenges are much more.
Not necessarily. So if that's what I said, that when you get somebody, you have to be very careful what kind of person you are getting in the organization. Your leaders has to be aligned on the similar value system. All leaders has to, it's like an orchestra, you know, everybody sings the same song. If your leadership team is aligned and you start demonstrating that behavior, no matter larger or small company, everybody value. One of the things which you said that about the multinational company. Now, multinational companies, what is that? The processes are very sacrosanct and they demonstrate, everyone demonstrate the same behavior. And many of the Indian companies, those come to a certain size and scale, they got to do that. Otherwise, you cannot become large.
Yeah.
Managing a large workforce is not an easy aspect. So I think that's a very, very simple rule. If you apply, any company can become, and I would be happy. I actually, mark my words, in 15, 20 years time, you will see equally large multinationals companies originating out of India. And there are many.
I'm not talking about business growth. So, I'm just talking about the work culture and the way
which is what I'm saying is that in that sense, if you just maintain a consistency of behavior, and if you demonstrate the same, so you have to tell them what you stand for, what is what is acceptable, what is not acceptable. It's not a banana republic. So I give an example now. When you travel overseas, same Indian never litters the road in overseas. The same guy who lands in Delhi airport or Bombay airport, first thing he comes is that he comes and throws certain things in the on the road. So it's an environment which you create in your company which makes a difference.
So big or small, it doesn't matter. No, my premise of saying that was that, you know, when it's a small family or when it's a fewer number of people, you know, it becomes like a family. Everybody has got access to everybody, you know, it's easily manageable. When it becomes a large extended family, say, you know, the chaos is less in nuclear families, can we say that, than it was in the joint families.
But the joint family, well-managed joint family brings immense joy.
Immense joy. I agree. Okay. What do you think, Dylan, my last question actually? What role does interpersonal skills, your interpersonal relationships, you know, play in maintaining a happy work culture?
Huge role.
Which I think is interpersonal skills would be beyond any policies. You can't, you know, basically control that. Yes.
Huge role. Interpersonal skills, empathy, and being a good human being plays the key role in whatever we spoke about.
Yeah. So we might have a very fancy office. We might have a great cool, uber cool culture. But if my relationship with my boss is not good, I will not be happy.
Absolutely not.
So how do you maintain that the interpersonal skills?
So basically, when you get somebody in the company, you have to assess those aspects very, very thoroughly in the company. So don't hire only for skill. Hire people for behavior. Hire people for right skill and right behavior. If you have a red flag, don't get somebody. Even if you make a mistake, do a lot of coaching with those people. Work personally on those people. So our HR team works very, very extensively with such individuals on a one-on-one basis, without making it a big noise. We have a ratio of 1:200 to 300 employees HR BP. So, you know, you have to go really deep in the people's side. You know your employees well. That's how you manage things. It's not that it's the environment is perfect and there are no friction. The frictions are inherently also a good thing to happen in the organization. Friction at times brings certain good things in organization. It brings out best at times in that. So that's what we do. I mean, very deep engagement with people, identify, work with them, don't single them out, work till the last moment if they can be corrected.
Thank you, Ashish. So that was Ashish sharing with us the different facets of employee happiness. Ashish, it was great talking to you, and thank you for coming.
Thank you very much. Yeah.